What?
The travel guy with Harry right now.
I'm just experiencing. What? You serious?
It's good, bro. You just do whatever you want here, man.
Dog. Oh man, I don't even know what to.
I gotta make a travel show.
I don't know. Have you ever been to Amsterdam? I'm just gonna be back up. You need to come. You literally can smoke it inside and outside.
I think outside it may be illegal. I think walking on the street, I think it's illegal, but it's not a big deal. You know what I'm saying? It's part of the culture.
It's like yeah. No, I feel you.
Yeah, I'm handsome.
You're handsome, dude. Look at his smile. Look at that, dude. You have a book. You have a fucking book. Look at it. That's his book.
No, that's making me shy.
Look at that's his book. He's holding it up. Congrats. Oh, they're happy for you too. Congrats, dude.
I almost died.
Oh, you made the meme of me.
I like the outfit.
Really?
Hey, Shay.
Thank you very much.
Hey.
I only eat chicken fingers Olaf because it's consistent. Anywhere in the world they have chicken fingers.
Fair enough.
So they taste like chicken fingers anywhere else, like from LA. And then you get French fries and they all taste the same. So I'm not trying anything exotic or new. I tried something exotic the other day and I got food poisoning. And I was like, that's my fuck. Literally, my friend was like, don't be a bitch, like try this pasta or whatever. Like ramen noodles. I was like, I feel like it's gonna get me sick. Took a bite. 20 minutes later, I had food poisoning. I'm just throwing up everywhere. I'm like, what the fuck? This is why I like chicken fingers and french fries. It seemed really funny. I was so drunk the other night. I don't know why. Bro, I drank like a whole bottle of like fucking tequila. And then I came home.
It was like an hour and a half though. Like, I'm going out. We're not sober. Came back. So, literally came back. Straight to the backyard. Throwing up.
Where?
I was in LA. I went to nice guy or some shit. And I don't know how I took like 5 shots of like just tequila. I took 3 shots of tequila and then it got to me. I guess I didn't eat all day. And then I blacked out.
Duh.
I blacked out. All I remember him taking off my pants and I put me to bed. I don't know shit. I remember him just be like, yo, dude, like here's food. He tried to make me food. I was like, throwing up. And then he's like, yo, then my pants were off and I was sitting on the ground.
Harry doesn't drink like this. He's like, oh, I got the spins for the first time. What's going on? Why am I spinning?
Oh, no,
like, I've been there so many times. Like, I got you.
I've never had the spins. I sat down the whole
time. You never had the spin.
I got like dizzy.
Yeah.
But like, I sat down. I felt like I just spin around 1,000 times.
Yeah.
Then I sat here. And the whole world was like flipping. And I felt like I was doing like.
When you talk about it, I remember, like, I don't drink anymore, but God, that spinning. When you talk about it right now, it's just like, oh my God, it's literally.
There's no point, it ruins everything. Like,
it's so heavy.
Because when it happens, you're like trying to find some control or find like some familiarity, so you just like breathe and hold them, just like hope that it just ends.
I know. No. I haven't been drunk in 3 years.
That's incredible.
3 years.
Do you smoke?
No.
Damn.
None. It's pretty rare, I guess.
Yeah. It's a lot of self-control.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like, yeah, in a sense.
You're fucking with these
people. Oh, for sure. But if I would drink or do anything on top of that, it would be so not sustainable, so you know, I would never be here, kind of. So I took that choice, and like it was such an easy choice when I did it, because I was on and off for like a certain amount of time, and I was like, I did like 6 months, 3 months, and then I was like, fuck, I really don't need this shit. And then I stopped like completely, did like a year, and then I went like a little on again, and then when I stopped after that, I was just like, alright, I'm actually done. Like, so I was black and white for like a little bit, and then I started like to take like a beer, like take a tequila shot, just, you know, just to not be stubborn.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't want to be black and white, because I've always been like that, so I just had to like find a balance. So if it's like, if I really want to take a beer, I like take a beer, like, so I just like, I don't gain anything. It's not about like self-control. I don't have a problem.
You just don't.
It's just like, you know.
What am I gonna do with
it? Yeah.
Journey.
Thank you, bro.
It was so
sick.
Good.
You're the bouncer. Really
cool. What's up?
Oh, yeah. What's up? Are you alive and kicking?
I'm very good.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Nice, man.
I just came from a Titan as well.
He's back already?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it's three.
Well, bro, he...
Oh, it's four. Yeah, he's back.
Yeah. He tore his ankle. Like, everything. He has to do surgery.
No, yeah. It's completely fucked.
Yeah, he got the answer from the MR now.
Fuck, I thought it was going to be less bad than that.
No.
Where he went in Holland or he went...
He went in Holland, yeah. So, we'll see. It's like...
Oh my god.
Yeah, he had 40 shows this summer, you know?
It's crazy, yeah?
Right?
So, the plan was to actually... get this building next to the other building and then paint everything white because it was like gray and depressing.
Yeah.
So I sprayed everything white and this was going to be my painting studio, like totally as a painting studio. And then my father discovered it and he basically put all this shit in it. That was bad. And this was going to be my little man cave.
Then you have this one and the black one outside.
Yeah, right? the black McLaren and this one. This is quite a like a rare. It's called a 488 Pista. Yeah, you see this thing, but it's
oh, you had
a stone
chip.
Yeah, so it cracked from the heat. You need to replace it, but now it's all the way to here. You see?
It just keeps going with the heat and everything.
This car is practically brand new. And we made this so I can just clip the canvas onto these clips, have it here, and then put my broom in the bucket like that, and then splash the paint over it. So this is a nice area. But I wanted to try something new, and that was this. And I just purchased this from America.
Yeah, boy.
So this is basically the ultimate tool to probably shoot paint, but I haven't tried it before, so we can try it now. See if
let me try this.
My brother is gonna be
straight through the wall,
bro.
Yeah, brother.
Yeah, I don't even need a painting studio. 2, 3, 2, 1. Count down, brother.
Yeah.
3, 2, 1. That's awesome. It looks pretty cool actually, the one with the lighting on it. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah!
3.
All the separate parts in bronze. Then we do the assembly. So we do the casting, all the separate parts. We make them in wax, and I'm going to show you just now how we do it in wax. So basically, we're starting at the end. Let's say we start making them in wax, and then we do the casting, and then we work all the way here. But every sculpture we make out of separate parts. You know, so this is one part, he's working on the legs, and then we start assembling, welding it together, but also taking away many imperfections. So there are always many, many imperfections in a bronze piece. So here was some welding, you see the discoloration here. So now we're grinding back the original shape. And this is a very small piece. We have also here is a larger sculpture.
This is basically a wax, and the waxes always need a lot of work, reworking. So there are many holes in it, many imperfections. So here everybody's working on a different wax model. And the red wax basically marks, you know, the work that's being done.
Bow wax is like the best way to do it?
Yes. Well, it's actually quite a traditional way of working. It's called lost wax method.
Okay.
It's a way of making bronze. So what do we do once we've made the wax model? We go into a process, it's called ceramic shell. So now we're going to take them and we're going to put sprues on it. I'll show you what it looks like. So that's like a channel where the bronze is going to flow in just now. And then we're going to dip that in tanks with ceramic material. Here's the temperature and the humidity. So we keep it cool, otherwise the wax melts and deforms. So here's a nice example. You see the blue wax head of a Pinocchio sculpture with all the work being done, seeing the red spots. And these are the channels we've designed, and the bronze will flow in from the top. So we're going to pour it in the cup. It's going to flow down, hit the bottom, and then find the thin channels. It's going to flow up again. And so everything you see here will be in bronze. So what we do is we take the wax. We're going to dip it into these tanks, dip it in, but we're going to wear suits and masks and everything. Yeah. We'll dip it in, and then we're going to put sand on it. It's a special sand. So we're going to take that, and then we're going to put sand on top of it. Looks like that. See? So you see the spaceman, you see the feet, you see the body parts, you see the arms, their arms.
Yeah.
So a sculpture is not just like a mold where you pour in the bronze.
Yeah.
It's a very delicate process of, you know, separate parts.
So these are now bronze, wax, and
no,
sand.
These are now wax with sand around it.
Okay.
This is only wax with sand around it. And now we're going to take this here. So we're going to put it into the oven, and then we're going to bake it. So it's now yellow. And once we've baked it, it's going to be white. There you see the white shells. And then we're going to take these bronze bars that we have here. We're going to put it into the pot, as you see. And then we're going to melt it at around 1200 degrees. So we're going to be wearing silver protective suits. We're going to melt it. And we're going to take the shells out of the oven when they're hot. We put it down. And then we're going to take the crane, pick up the pot and pour the bronze into it. And then we're going to let the shell cool down, and we're going to chisel off all the white ceramic material, and then we're going to go to the sandblasting, clean it off, and then we can start assembling, welding, grinding, and eventually polishing. So for every bronze sculpture, you have to do the whole process. It's crazy. This is the result, this is the end result. So after years of work, then come here. It's crazy, huh? I mean, check this out. This is also bronze, huh?
It's completely like painted bronze, but it's like 1400 kilograms.
Wow.
But standing here is like, it's like 5 years of work. 5 years of concept, of creation, of turning a drawing into reality. Like this set here, the first one we made, 2013.
I'm amazed.
Yeah. If you've never seen it in real life, only like on Instagram and stuff.
No, that's the thing.
You see it, yeah.
But then, like, that's like the really, really sick part about exactly this type of art as well, because you have this appearance on Instagram,
yeah,
like where you can take photos off a piece and it won't do it literally like one in a million, like justice, you know,
to the experience.
For what it actually is.
Yeah.
But like a photo, it's like, then you have like all the steps to there is not, or it's not that many steps before you can, because it's a photo. Mm. So you post it on Instagram, it's a photo, you know. This is like, that's what I really, really like about it. It's like the experience of it. And you like, you, even though you can post it anywhere, like literally on like any media, any like you want, undersell it, because this is like what it is.
That, that's the problem in a way, you know, that people think they've seen it until you see it in real life.
Yeah.
It's like, then you feel the emotion.
Yeah.
For the piece. Especially in real life, I find it's good reproducible in a way. This one, like the screen print, is flat and has a lot of power and emotion. But if you take a picture of the real sculpture, it's very difficult to reproduce. But when you see it in real life, it's like, holy shit, man. I mean, if you see the size of the head, and like this is bronze, like painted bronze, you see the elastic band, and it's a piece that weighs like 350 kilograms, it's heavy, big, and you know, all the hairs. Now you can see, if you've seen the metal process, you understand that we've been grinding between every little hair to get it like that. It's just insane.
I'm kind of speechless, straight up. Like, this is, I really, I...
Especially if you have like something like this, like this sort of process, like you just stand close and you see how detailed it is.
It's like,
it's crazy to.
I gotta put down my camera down now, and then I'll walk around for a little bit, because this is.
You need to just walk around and experience it yourself.
It's amazing that you do this shit, really. That you just get this whole factory that is actually like, it's fully working, and you can be able to get an output on what's in your head like this. It's the ultimate goal
because you know it, like you're a creator and you have a concept, you want to do something, and then you put everything together to make a video or a picture, but to make a physical object and do the whole process and make, I mean, like there's, I'm only going to make like five of these pieces. I do the whole process to make five.
Yeah.
And then you scrap it and you do something else. You know, it's like a journey of, it can be 1, 2, or 3 years to think of and create a sculpture, and then that chapter is done. It's in existence, and then you go on to the next one.
Because the hand of work, and it's like, that's like the, because it's one thing, like we can value our thoughts. Like now I talk in the art, but I'll talk about your thoughts. That's like one value, you know?
Yeah.
But then you have the other side of the value that is like at least 50% of it.
Yeah.
At least. And that's all you have built for yourself here to actually make this shit work.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, it's one thing to come up with the idea. But the other thing is you also need to find a process to make the idea happen.
No, 100%.
You need to build a complete working ecosystem as an artist to be able to think of something and then to make it to this level. Because
In this case, yes.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there are many art foundries that can do bronze, but like when we started out, we have had seven different external foundries to help make the pieces. I'm talking about 5 to 6 years ago. Everybody said we're going to do it, and nobody could deliver. So out of pure necessity and quality, we have built a studio to only make my work. It's like all the people here, like 30 people, are dedicated to help me realize my concepts, you know?
If you would just be, say, an artist that can do everything himself, like just a painting, something you could do yourself.
Yeah.
In this case, like you need that whole world around
that,
it.
That takes
to make it happen.
Two different people, kind of, to actually like be the thoughts behind this and actually be the thoughts behind what we just saw.
Yeah, that's like, and luckily I have my dad helping with the studio part
because
he's very technical and he thinks about it 24/7, so he can help me, you know.
That's why I'm saying like either it's like two sides of you, or it's like two different people, now kind of the same blood, or like the same head, you know. And that's like, I literally couldn't, like I'm kind of straight up like kind of jealous that you have your like dad here, you know, actually like doing something like this together with your dad.
And
it's like, you kidding me?
Yeah.
It's like you like.
Yeah, my brother's here and his wife is here and my mom. And so it's like I'm doing this with my complete family and then external team. It's the dream, you know, to just keep it going, to be able to work with your family like that. Is really worth it.